NHRA qualifying is coming up next. There are four drivers in Top Fuel in contention for the championship, including that man, Antron Brown, who is trying to become the first African-American to win a championship in NHRA. But he's not yet qualified. Will he make it? Check us out coming up next. One man has already clinched an NHRA championship. Jason Line closed the door on the Pro Stock competition just 2 weeks ago. One crowned, and now three to go. In Top Fuel, four stand ready to race in the tightest fight of them all. The points lead has even changed in qualifying. We'll show you the highlights starting with session one.
Tony Schumacher and Brandon Bernstein. Tony Schumacher still trying to get that first win of the season. His championship hopes will be eliminated at the end of qualifying, but this is going to help a lot. A 382 laps time gets him in the number one spot.
Larry Dixon with his eyes on a championship, currently fourth, and Antron Brown currently third. But Antron Brown doesn't get down the track and doesn't make it into the top 12 that will transfer over to the second session.
Next up, Spencer Massey, number one in the points against Del Worsham, number two in the points, only 2 points behind Spencer. But watch this run. They run pretty much identical. Del Worsham slightly quicker with that 383.0, and because of the little points, he now moves within 1 point of Spencer Massey.
And then, in the second session of qualifying, Antron Brown, once again, trying to get it in, once again. No, he cannot. Don Schumacher saying, what is going on with my contender?
Next up, you're on board with Spencer Massey alongside of Morgan Lucas. Spencer Massey trying to improve on his qualifying. He's not able to do that. He runs a 385 elapsed time at 316 miles per hour and does not pick up any bonus points.
Here's Del Worsham and Tony Schumacher. Del Worsham took over the points lead. Tony Schumacher still looking for his first win of this year. What a shock that is. Worsham, a 383, a 389 for Tony Schumacher. They are going to stay number one and number two.
And with that, Del Worsham takes over the point lead by 2 points.
And Antron Brown is still waiting to qualify, despite the fact that he is just 17 points back from the points lead in Top Fuel. Let's send you over to Dave Reeve.
2001 was the last time we had a Top Fuel champion not named Dixon or Schumacher. Will it be this man, Del Worsham? He's the point leader heading into this final day. But Del, this is a position in 21 years of racing you've not been in. You've seen it from afar. But how different is it living in the moment?
It's special. It's exciting. This race basically, you know, is coming down to what's going to be the final day and what I believe could possibly become the final round of Sunday. So for Shake Callahan and Alan Johnson and this team, they've been in this position before. They've won from this position before. And personally, I like it. It's fun. Finally, after 21 years, I'm living a dream.
Right in his own backyard. Hey, have fun.
Yeah, the battle isn't only tight in Top Fuel. How about Funny Car? This is session one.
Ron Capps alongside of Robert Height. Ron coming off that win in Las Vegas makes a nice run with a 412. But look at Robert Height go the head of the class with a 4.080 laps time.
And that brings up Cruz Pedregon and Mike Neff, both contenders in the championship. Neff runs a 4.08 with a 7, good enough for second. Cruz Pedregon doesn't get down the track, doesn't qualify.
Next up, Matt Hagan, your points leader, alongside second in points, Jack Beckman. Jack smokes the tires. Matt Hagan goes down the track, runs a 4.13, but doesn't pick up any bonus points, ends up in the fifth spot.
In the second session, here is Cruz Pedregon. He's trying once again to get into this field. Little trouble at the top end, a bit of a wiggle. Cruz runs a 4.44. That gets him in for now, but he'll be bumped later.
Next up, it's Alexis DeGioia and Jack Beckman. Jack needing desperately to get into this field. Both cars are going to go down the track. Alexis makes a nice run. Jack Beckman, he runs a 4.13 at 310 miles per hour, puts him in the fifth spot. No bonus points, but he's in the show.
Here is John Ford. Tony Pedregon. Force has been struggling so hard this season. The finals here doesn't add to it. Big explosion. John Forrest, 431, 436 for Tony Pedregon. And John Forrest, in doing so, drives over the line. They throw it out. John Forrest has his problems, Mike.
Yes, he has. He's been struggling big time with that cylinders out and spinning the tires, and backfires a supercharger. He's not in the show. So next up, we got Ron Capps and Matt Hagen. The teammates, Capps smokes the tires. Matt Hagen, look at that, a 408 at 310 miles per hour. That'll end up picking up 3 bonus points.
And if it stays, that's going to just be the best for Matt Hagen. But what about Robert Height and Mike Neff? They're up at the line now. Height, he runs a 410. It's a 412 for Mike Neff. Robert Height is number one, and Mike Neff is number two. And the guy that has really got his problems is third in the points, but just like Antron Brown and Top Fuel, he is not yet qualified into this field. Let's go to John Kernan.
For the second straight year, Matt Hagen comes into Pomona as the points leader in the battle for the Funny Car Championship. And Matt, I have a feeling things might be a little bit different. You guys seem a little more loose this year. Did you learn a lot from last year and losing the title to John Force on the last day that'll help you win it this year?
Well, you know, it's a tough situation last year. I mean, we obviously don't want to go through that again. But this year, you know, I think a lot of guys here realize that a lot of this stuff's out of our control. We're going to go up there and do the best job we can and let it unfold how it may.
And, of course, in qualifying, those little bonus points, as close as it is with he and his teammate Jack Beckman, those little bonus points could go a long way in determining the championship.
We'll be watching for Matt Hagen. Track temperature currently 32 degrees. This is the first pair of Funny Car. We mentioned them, John Forrest and Bob Bodie. And here after the two sessions is the way they lined up. We showed you the highlights. Height number one, Neff, Hagen. Down to 12th. They'll be adding in after 12th now.
That's because we carry over only the top 12 after two sessions. As you look at the cars that are not in, including the two on the line, Bob Bodie and John Forrest. Now obviously, Cruz Pedregon really needs to make a good run right now in this session.
Boy, that is an impressive list of not qualified.
Well, right now, as you look at John Forrest, they've been struggling quite a bit. The track conditions, you got cool track temperatures in the 70-degree range, so the track's very tight. I believe that they're going to want to run about a 4:15 a lap time or quicker to really feel like they've got a shot at staying qualified in this field.
72 degrees, and they'll be adding in now. 12 are already in. This will be the first add to that 12-car field. John Forrest gets her down, runs a 4:13, 308 miles an hour, moves in to the top half of the field at sixth. Bob Bodie is in, now 13th. And here are two Funny Car heavy hitters at the line, Ron Capps and Bob Tasca. Like the cloud layer is thinning a little bit over the track, clearing up. Mike Dunn said we were going to get all four qualifying sessions in. I guess I have to go with Mike now, though there is still a threat of rain off to the west. So Ron Capps, he's always racing something. Straight line, oval, he doesn't care. Last week he was at the Hot Rod reunion.
He just loves to race, period. But I think his favorite thing is drive fuel Funny Cars. He would definitely tell you that. And he's got to be happy right now. You know, confident in his team with Tim and Kim Richards after winning that race in Las Vegas. And they're currently qualified in the number five spot, looking to improve on a 4:12 elapsed time.
Mike, talking to a lot of crew chiefs down here, this is not a time to be shy. And what an interesting situation with perhaps that threat of rain. You want to go up there and take the car down the racetrack, go A to B, but the conditions right now are so good. You talked about the track temperature, 72. Some crew chiefs told me that this track is almost as good right now the track I'm speaking of as Redding was. And remember how good Redding was. The air's not very good, but these guys have a track right now they can sink their teeth into.
Yeah, we saw the atmospheric conditions, and there's a lot of moisture in the air right now, which has taken away some oxygen. So that's the difference in the condition we saw in Redding, that it was just optimum to be able to make horsepower, and you had a very fast racetrack.
Both guys are in. This is just an opportunity to improve on that. Task of 4:14, caps of 4:15. They don't improve on their time set in the first session, and they will remain fifth and ninth. Ron Capps, the guy that has gone from not qualifying to a win this season. And back in the staging lanes, Cruz Pedregon is not yet qualified in this field. Cruz is definitely in contention, third in the points. Getting in this field is so important. You think he's not nervous right now? And how about this guy, Matt Hagen? He's looking for the championship again. He was doing that last year at this very race. Didn't make it. John Forrest did. Remember how dejected? He's probably pretty nervous too. ESPN's presentation of the Automobile Club of Southern California NHRA Finals is brought to you by Full Throttle. Grab a Full Throttle energy drink and feel the energy at work. Auto Club, we're always with you. And Castro GTX High Mileage, help extend the life of your engine. Well, we've got some major players who are not in this field yet, as we are in the third session of qualifying. Antron Brown is one of them, though he sounds pretty good there. And the other one is on the line. That guy is Cruz Pedregon at the Auto Club of Southern California Nationals. Well, think about this day for Cruz, and in fact for everybody else. There's a threat of rain throughout the day. It's got to drive the officials nuts, but even more the participants, the contenders especially, because will this be the last session or will it be the next one? That's a problem. Now, what about the mindset? How do you figure out what you're going to do and where do you put your brain for a day like this?
Well, the key is to be calm and be focused, but sometimes it's hard to be focused when you have these kind of conditions, especially when you're a guy like Cruz Pedregon, who also helps in the tune-up of that race car. Sometimes you can overthink it. From the driver's standpoint, he knows what he has to do. Just stay focused, keep that thing in the middle of the lane, and try to get this car in the field.
Well, guess what? It's time for our Castrol GTX High Mileage One to watch. Guess who?
It's the Cruz. Because he's not in the show, but he is a six-time number one qualifier this season. He has the most bonus points in qualifying. Also has six career wins in the countdown era, the most of any funny car driver. And remember, he won the championship and the race on the final day of the season in 2008.
Well, that other car, which is a Senko, he's going away, but it's Cruz Pedregon. 34 events since he last failed to qualify. He does hold the track record ET here. Lots of stuff at play. This run, absolutely critical. There may not be another opportunity for Cruz.
He's in the right lane. You want to stay to the right side of that group because it tends to want to drive the cars towards the center. There it is. Nice.
408 with a 7, 307 miles an hour, not just in, but in at number three. Man, that guy handles pressure.
Well, he's been doing this for a very long time, but he's been making great calls along with Danny DeGennaro, his co-crew chief along here, along for the for the ride here, Cruz Pedregon, that is. He's making a great run down the racetrack. The key is here, I mean, they backed that thing down. It went a 408 lap time. This car's capable of running a 401 or 402 at any time when he hits it.
Dave Reif. Well, Danny, we talked to Cruz yesterday. He admitted maybe being a little aggressive yesterday, but talk about the thought process on what's a tricky day. Great track with the threat of rain.
You know, the better the track is, sometimes it's harder to run one of these race cars. So we actually came up here conservative. I was a little bit worried about being over-conservative. Obviously, we blew it both shots Thursday and Friday. We got to make it in this thing for the championship. The car did exactly what we needed it to do. We'll try to step on it next run.
Conservative? 408? Wow.
And here is Beckman and John Capps. This is where the little points may come in. To the top end and Gary Gerald.
Well, we're standing by with Cruz Pedregon, and of course, you guys set the scene eloquently in how significant that pass was for Cruz and his team. Third in points, two rounds back. He won the championship 3 years ago at this racetrack in most dramatic fashion. How difficult has it been to stay calm, to stay focused with this kind of pressure?
Well, I think that's where experience pays off. Well, I've been in this position before, and, you know, the last two championships we didn't get down the track Friday either, so we've been here before. We knew the car had a great run. It's so hard to slow a fast car down, and, you know, that's not to sound cocky, but, you know, we only know how to run, and that's running the balls to the wall, so it, you know, we pulled it back just a little bit there, but not too crazy, because we still have to run good, and, you know, I don't want to learn how to run slow, so, but the hats off to the Snap-on team. My guys hung in there, and, you know, the car hung together, and it made a good run, but I think we can, you know, we can get, we now we can breathe and get after maybe a little bit.
Get any sleep last night?
No, not hardly.
Well, at least he can relax a bit now.
So here is Jack Beckman. Cruz is in the field, obviously, and Beckman, Hagen pulled to 4 points ahead of Beckman using the little points. Those points are awarded for quickest ETs, 1, 2, and 3, after each session. Now, Jack Beckman, if he can come up with the quickest ET of this session, can close to within one, depending on what Hagen does, of course. John Capps is out of it right away. Beckman gets her down there, 4.11, 313 miles an hour. So no bonus points for Jack. He moves from 11th up to 7th. Top Fuel is going to be coming up shortly, back in the staging lanes in his traditional position. Sitting on the wheelie bar of his Top Fuel dragster is Spencer Massey, who arrived here number one in the points, but with a little points. Del Worsham has already moved around him. Will he be able to answer back? We'll have coverage of the finals of the Auto Club of Southern California Finals at 7 o'clock on Sunday. You think that ain't going to be a barn burner? You bet. Look at the clouds over the San Gabriel Mountains. Possibility of weather. Final championship days. Man, this event has all of the ingredients. It's Robert Height and Mike Neff up now, the teammates.
Did I tell you on E3 yesterday that it wasn't going to rain? We're going to get two sessions in today.
You told me that.
Okay. Right now,
Mike, here's a clue. Day's not over.
Come on, Paul. We're good. Right now, we're watching the teammates, Neff and Height.
Robert, 409, 414 for Neff. They're going to stay 1 and 2.
Well, both cars going down the racetrack. Robert Height's looking very good. Jimmy Prosh giving a good tune-up. I'm sure they're probably trying to run a little bit more than a 409, but still a nice pass.
And here comes the current points leader, but only by 4. Matt Hagen leads over Jack Beckman. Quickest runs of the session, and the tiny points that go along with that. Melanie Troxell quickest thus far, followed by Cruz and Robert on that run you just saw. So here comes Matt Hagen and Tim Wilkerson.
And Antron Brown getting ready for what could be the most important, what is the most important qualifying pass of the year thus far. And not in the field right now. What's been going through your mind since yesterday?
A lot of everything. You know, the thing about it is that when you look at a forecast and you know you got a sunny day, no problem, we got two runs today, you know what I mean? But when you look at the forecast, it's all rain all day, we're like, oh no, not this. So last night, not too much sleep, but I'm smiling today because the clouds are breaking up. You see some sunny skies out there, and looks like we're gonna get at least one run in and probably two runs in. So I'm pretty stoked about that. And now it's up to us to go do what we do, and we control our own destiny. So we're gonna go out here, do what we do, have some fun, and try to get this thing in the show.
Thank you.
All right.
As you take a look at Tim Wilkerson, it's interesting how good this session has been thus far. Tim Wilkerson started out the session in 4th position. He has been bumped down to 9th. by virtue of all those 408s and 409s that we've been seeing.
I love watching Tommy DeLago, the crew chief for Matt Hagan. He's there, man. He is in this game. Wilkerson climbs out of it. Low
wow.
on the session. 403, 315, and new number one. That's why I like DeLago. Hagan does a pretty good job, too.
But this was all Tommy DeLago. I think Matt was just long for the ride. He'll tell you that. When it's running like that, you don't have to do a whole lot of driving. He did a little on the other end. You saw Tommy DeLago give that fist pump. 4:03 elapsed time. One little move just before the finish line. Great run out of that diehard Dodge.
Wow, that thing was pretty, Dave Reeve.
Now, Tommy D, exclamation point with that 4:03. Tell me a little bit about your thought process and what you wanted to accomplish.
Just want to go down the track. Excuse me. I just want to go down the track as best we can. I mean, we're having a lot of fun. We're enjoying it this year, and that makes you enjoy it a little bit more. But it ain't going to mean nothing on race day. We'll see what happens.
Pretty good for right now, though.
So Tommy DeLago really shows his stuff along with Matt Hagan, and we'll show you now what the funny car points are like. Hagan sitting up there with 7 points ahead of Jack Beckman now. Is that guy?
Well, as Tommy DeLago mentioned, what happens today really doesn't matter on race day. And here's to back that fact up. Last year, they had the most bonus points going into Sunday. They had 7. Second was Jack Beckman. We all know what happened on Sunday on race day.
Well, and you saw when you saw the points, Mike Neff has dropped down to 38 behind. He was 35 when we started the session, so he just slowly going down the points. He's got to make something happen now. He could lose an entire round. Here is Funny Car qualifying the standings after the third of 4 sessions with Matt Hagan taking over number one, followed by Height, Neff, then Melanie Troxell, who is looking good but not in the countdown, then Cruz Pedregon, Johnny Gray, Jeff Oren, and Jack Beckman, who is in the countdown.
Some big names in the bottom eight. You see Ron Capps there in 10th, John Force 11th, the bump spot, Bob Bodie with a nice 4:19.9 elapsed time.
When we come back, Top Fuel, Antron Brown suiting up. He is still not qualified for this field. And then there is Spencer Massey. Remember, he had a DNQ during the countdown playoffs. No one has ever had a DNQ in the playoffs and gone on to the championship. What do you think Spencer Massey can do?
1,000 horses loose. Grab a gear and hit the juice. I'll take a shot.
There's the goal, the championship Wally. In Top Fuel, there are 4 contenders left. It'll be decided on Sunday. These 4 are separated by less than 50 points. But for Antron Brown, the question is, can he even get in the field so that he can go for the championship? As of this moment, Antron Brown has not yet qualified, and 2 qualifying sessions have already gone by. It's getting awful tight for him. Here are the standings right now. Tony Schumacher, number one. He is not a contender. Dell Worsham, Spencer Massey are. So is Larry Dixon, and Antron's not in.
Well, as we take a look at the bottom eight, you're going to see Mike Salinas is on the bump with that 4:14 elapsed time. That's the number that Antron's going to have to beat, but he's probably going to want to run at a mid-380 pass.
Well, Mike, I talked with Brian Carotti. The combination he uses in the bell housing is 3 brand new clutch discs to 2 used ones. Recently, he had to change one heading into Vegas and the other used one heading into here. The car is just simply too aggressive. Now, why would that be?
Well, because all those clutch discs, no matter how the manufacturing process go, they are not consistent. So obviously, these discs are possibly a little bit more aggressive, but I heard they're just not wearing as much as the other ones and doesn't see them clutch too early in the run.
4:14 with
there
the 2 is the target, yeah. And it's a 3:84. He is in the field, in the top half, and Antron Brown is number 6. And so all 4 contenders in the fight for the Top Fuel Championship are now in the field, Dave.
Well, Brian Carotti looks like he can sleep a little bit better tonight. Just talking a little bit about the situation with the clutch discs. You feel like you got it calmed down enough now?
Yeah, we were going to go back to our, you know, what we did in Vegas before we came into Vegas, but we felt that what we did here yesterday and Thursday, it was the path that we needed to go on to be more consistent. So we left it alone, and, you know, we made some clutch movement adjustments. You know, we, our flows might have been a little too fast for the disc that we had in there.
How many times you pour over the data before sending it up there right now?
I poured over the data. I haven't slept in 2 days.
We'll sleep better tonight.
Let's go to the top end. Gary Gerald has points leader in funny car, Matt Hagan.
When he comes out of the car, I don't know that there's anybody quite as animated as Matt Hagan. The eyes particularly are so expressive, and then the big smile that goes with a terrific pass lower the session. Most significantly, three more of those little bonus points. So you have a plus 7 over your teammate right now. Does that improve your comfort zone at all?
Well, first of all, I got to say thank you to my guys. They're working so hard, you know, and this diehard car is running really good out here. Tommy DeLago is really getting a handle on it, but things change quick around here, so we're trying to stay humble with it. But I tell you know, the point thing, it's nice to have. The biggest thing that we're trying to do right now is gobble up some points so that even if, you know, when we roll into Sunday, that they got to put a whole nother round on us to win, you know, and hopefully we don't have to go down to that. But you just never know with these championships. It's going to come right down to the wire. The fans are going to get their money, and you know, we're gonna have some fun doing it, but I think that it's a gut wrencher, but who would want it any other way?
It's a gut wrencher, but I tell you, as a fan, we're loving it.
Absolutely. I'm loving it as a driver.
What a great attitude. Matt Hagan on the line. Tony Schumacher currently number one, and Brandon Bernstein at ninth, trying to get into the top half. Brandon has not won since the end of 2009. Oh, now there is a sweet run
nice
for Bo.
Run.
Look at it. 380 with a one for Schumacher. He betters his time here in the third session. Remains number one, and Bernstein moves up three positions. He's now sixth. We'll go to the top end and Gary Gerald.
Virtually the first words out of Antron's mouth when he heard the time and the speed numbers, now we can play. That's got to feel pretty good after the last several hours.
It does. It does. The biggest thing, we know we had two runs today. But the thing about it was the weather didn't look like we were going to get any runs. So to get down the track and get that run, I had all the confidence in the world in my team. And we just needed the weather to act right. That's what we were so nervous about. And it did. Guy was up there looking out after us. The glory goes to him. And we're going to go out now. We can play a little bit now. So if we get another run, we can actually lean on it and see what the track's going to hold. That's what we're doing the first two runs. But we just want one to stick because, I mean, we're in this championship thick of things. And we want to run for that number one spot. And we got to go after it.
Thanks, Ant.
I was standing with Antron back in the pits this morning. Boy, his fan base is great. He was working on his fuel, and they were saying, "You'll do it, Antron." I mean, they were giving him every kind of encouragement. Larry Dixon is fourth in the points. He needs to do some catching up to his teammate, Del Worsham, who currently sits number one. Larry Dixon's looking for back-to-back championships, but he is going to have to really move if he wants that.
Playing that spoiler role, but right now Larry Dixon, he is in that points battle, but boy, you got some good cars ahead of him, including, you know, obviously Del Worsham and Spencer Massey. Right now they need to step up in the performance just a little bit. They've got the consistency though.
Larry Dixon.
There it is.
79, 321 miles an hour, number one right now, and the 3 points, which just may put him one round behind.
But the key is they stepped up the performance. We know they Absolutely. Can do it, but they have been very consistent. They don't hurt very many parts. They haven't really ran the big number as much as they'd like to. That, though, right there was a very nice pass. Take one more look at it. They were going 284 miles per hour at the eighth mile. That indicates the track is tight, and they took advantage of it.
Now Larry Dixon goes number one from fifth place and shows further that that car has got everything that it needs to get down the track and maybe get him yet another championship. Here's the final pair, and it's the teammate to Larry Dixon, Del Worsham and Spencer Massey. The chase for the NASCAR Sprint Cup continues with the Cobalt 2's 500 at Phoenix. Coverage begins Sunday at 2. So you're on board with Spencer. Spencer had the points lead when they arrived here. this guy, Del Worsham, took it away from him. Now, you've got Larry Dixon, the quickest ET of the session. And these two guys have a chance to eclipse it. Gary Gerald.
With Larry Dixon as he came climbing out of there, how good does that feel? Because for the moment, that's three of those little bonus points in your pocket.
Oh, for the second, we're going to end up with at least one bonus point out of the deal. I mean, there's two strong cars that are up there on the line right now. For Shea Kelly, Allen, Army Team, Jason did a hell of a job that time. It was a nice ride. I saw that 79 come up on the board. I said, right on. He did great.
He may be flying just a little bit under the radar, but look out, defending champion at work.
Yeah, well, it's time to go to altitude and get on the radar because there's just one more session and then final eliminations, and then the season is over. There are the points right now. Dell leads, Spencer two back, Antron back 17, Larry Dixon 45 back.
Well, 45 back, that's three rounds out. Nobody's counting out Larry Dixon, but all eyes are on Del Worsham and Spencer Massey on the starting line right now. Del Worsham, your national record holder with that 373. He's not going to get to that, but he can definitely get to the number one spot, as could Spencer.
Well, we're seeing him go down. Hey, nice. Spencer Massey, a 380 for Dell. It's a 377. Dell is now number one, and the 3 points are going to be his. His teammate will pick up two.
And I'll tell you what, that is key because Dell Worsham came in here 2 points behind Spencer Massey. Going into eliminations, that will be one round behind. Because of the bonus points, Dell Worsham, it looks like he is going to be ahead. Spencer will be one round behind going into elimination, and that is huge for that Allen-Abbey Racing Team and Dell Worsham.
Now Brian Huzins, his crew chief, smile on his face, likes that number, but told me you guys are coming from a little bit behind this weekend.
Yeah, we just been struggling a little bit this weekend to make some horsepower, so we made some moves there to see where we were at, and it seemed like it worked out good. So it's a tough battle right now, man. Everything counts.
How's your team, your guys taking everything?
Oh, they're ready, man. They're just having a good time and want to win a race and win a championship and have fun no matter what happens. But we're doing all right. We're happy.
We're definitely going into race day with the point lead.
So the standings now in Top Fuel, and they've changed dramatically just in this one session. Del Worsham is now number one. Larry Dixon was number one for one run. And Tony Schumacher, of course, came into the session as the number one qualifier. Schumacher now mathematically out of the game for a championship. Spencer Massey is still in that game, as is Worsham, Dixon, and Antron Brown.
Take a look at the bottom eight. Doug Coletta, Bob Vandegrift, ninth and tenth. Former Funny Car driver Mike Ashley, driving for Dexter Tuttle, is on the bump with a 3.95 six elapsed time.
The only two contenders left in Pro Stock Motorcycle, Eddie Krawick and Hector Arana Jr. But Arana Jr. is way back in the points. Gonna have to step his game up if he wants that championship Wally. In Funny Car, Mike Neff has been slowly losing points. He can't afford that. He needs to get some points back, or he will find himself out of contention. So cold, it steals your soul. It takes more than hope. Top Fuel driver Spencer Massey warms it up for the Auto Club of Southern California Finals. He came here as number one in the points, but since then, Del Worsham has driven around him. In fact, has done so well that Spencer Massey cannot recapture number one during qualifying. We'll have coverage of when he can, though, which will be Sunday, 7 o'clock, when we have the finals, the last race of the season. We'll determine the champion, 7 o'clock Sunday night on ESPN2. Now it's time to take a look at Pro Stock Motorcycles. Here's round one.
Session number one, you got Matt Smith and Andrew Hines. Andrew on the Harley, picking the front end up all the way down that racetrack. Makes a great pass to go to the number one spot. A 682 elapsed time at 197 miles per hour.
Here's Hector Arana Jr. and Eddie Krawick. They are the only two contenders for the championship in Pro Stock Motorcycle. Arana Jr. gets down the track with a 683. It's a 685 at 195 miles an hour for Eddie Krawick. They go 2 and 3.
Next up, it's Matt Smith and Hector Arana Jr. from session number two. Matt has problems right off the get-go. Hector Arana Jr. has some problems down the track, only runs a 742 and misses out on them all-important bonus points.
So again, in the second session, here are the teammates. Number one, Andrew Hines, and number three, Eddie Krawick. Krawick is going to lay down a 685. It's a 684 for Hines. 198.12 miles an hour. New track record, fourth fastest in history.
And in session number three, it's Karen Stouffer alongside of that man, Hector Rana Jr. Once again, remember, he's trying to get them big bonus points, has tremendous early numbers, but then he can't get the motorcycle to shift down track. Karen Stouffer runs a 6:92 laps time to get her in the show.
And our John Kernan is now with Eddie Krawick.
And Eddie, final qualifying pass of the day. You know, you got that great lead going into tomorrow. Just, you know, can you give us a hint as to what you're feeling now?
I feel good. I just got to keep it consistent, go down there and do like I've been doing all year long. That's what I've done. That's what I'm going to continue to do. No reason to change anything now.
So Eddie Krawick, as he prepares to hop on that Harley-Davidson V-Rod. And we take a look at the line. Next pair coming up, we'll look at the points. Eddie Krawick, Hector Arana Jr., 70 back. That is huge. He needs to make something happen. Or that man, Eddie Krawick, is going to end up as the champion. Let's show the standings for you as well in Pro Stock Motorcycle with Andrew Hines sitting number one, followed by Arana Jr. and then Eddie Krawick. So second and third, that's your battle for the championship.
Let's take a look at the bottom eight. The field is set. As you can see, Angie Smith, Chip Ellis in that ninth and 10th spot. Jerry Savoy in 11th. Michael Phillips is on the bump with a 6:95 five elapsed time.
And so we go to the line where Angie Smith on her Buell. This will be her 50th start if she can get it done. Chip Ellis is on his Buell. We haven't seen him for a while. Right now, Angie is ninth, so she looks pretty solid. Ellis is 10th.
Well, they're both guaranteed they're going to be racing tomorrow, but they would obviously like to be able to step up and get in the top half of the field. 690 with a zero, so they're going to have to run a 689 or 680 anything right now to get into the top half.
Pro Stock Motorcycle, kind of threatening skies, but we've dodged the rain most of the day. Angie runs a 6:93, a 6:92 for Ellis. They're going to stay right where they were. Angie, wow, did you see that? Ooh, wonder what happened there. Just wiggled the bike and then got it back under control. Let's go to Gary Gerald.
1 second.
How much have you just taken care of business laying down that number one run and picking up three bonus points?
Yeah, well, you know, these little points can matter, and one point, when you're racing for 20 points around, it can be huge. And wow, man, what a job. Alan Johnson, Brian, Alan Abbey, Shea Callard at home watching us. That's the run they needed. And man, when I saw Larry go 79 in front of me, Alan said, we're good, we're okay. And he wasn't kidding.
Nice job.
Thank you.
Oh, the Shake's watching. Hey to the Shake, how you doing? Ellie Tonglet and Michael Ray, Suzuki and Buell. Michael Ray ran a career best in qualifying earlier. Sits on a 6:90, is eighth. In sixth right now is Tonglet. He ran a 6:89 in the third session of qualifying.
Whoa.
Wow.
Both
of them. Well, it's one thing. We're going to push it back and go again, right? No.
No, they don't allow that. But Michael Ray's been having problems along with Matt Smith with the two-step button. But you could hear Ellie Thomas sound like his bike just broke something in the transmission or a chain or something. Boy, you heard the engine just rev up big time right there.
Well, that's seen some weird stuff today. I mean, Bailey Whitaker has a chain go.
Yeah, I mean, we've seen a lot of bikes today have problems getting off the starting line, too. It's just one of those things.
Well, you're talking the end of the season, and everybody's either trying something new or trying very hard. Ellie Tonglet walks his way back. Another interesting story here this weekend is Mike Berry. Let's go to Dave.
Yeah, Mike Berry, who'd like to be out on the motorcycle participating right now, but you kind of got a lot of concern from everybody here. What happened to you back in the pits? Great story.
Yeah, I actually had a wrench on the crankshaft turned and knocked me unconscious.
And you can see some of that damage. Just look right here. There's some stitches there. Now, you got airlifted. At what point, when you came to, what were you thinking?
I couldn't believe it, but I thought, almost feels like I'm in a helicopter. And sure enough, I was.
As far as long-term damage, did you get a concussion out of that?
They didn't say anything about it, but basically any time that you have, like, brain type of stuff, they did a bunch of CAT scans and everything came up negative, so it's a good thing. But I definitely, you know, I'm on Vicodin and stuff, so I'm kind of a little loopy right now. But.
Well, it's good to see you back here because there was a lot of crazy rumors going around here.
This is Arana and Matt Smith. What a weird story for Barry. Arana, 688. Smith, 691. They're going to stay fourth and seventh. I've always wondered about that when you get airlifted. If you wake up during the flight and, like, you're looking out the window and see nothing but sky, do you think maybe you went to heaven?
Thought maybe you checked out?
Yeah, might have.
I don't know. I never got hauled away in a helicopter. A few ambulances, though.
I remember getting knocked out in Blue Angel 7 once, and I wasn't real happy with that one. So we take you back to the line, and here comes Hector Arana Jr., currently second, and Sean Gann. There's that 70-point break between Eddie Krawick and Arana Jr.
And that is four rounds of racing, so...
That's a win, right? That's the only way.
And Eddie's going to have to go out, so he's got his work cut out for him.
Let's go to the stat guy.
Well, Mike, we saw that run in session three where Hector Jr. broke. He had an incredible 60-foot time, one of the best ones ever. He was really quick to the 3:30. He was actually 12 thousandths of a second quicker than when his dad made the quickest pass of all time at Gainesville when he ran that 6:77. That bike has got some power.
Boy, it was gonna make a pass last session because that thing was flying early.
Two spot. Eddie Krawick, it's gonna be a single for Hector Arana Jr. Sean Gann was supposed to come up with him, but he already qualified well, and no need to do that. But there's that. It must be a bump out there. Arana Jr., 6:85. That is low of the session, and he stays number two. But low of the session means he's going to pick up those 3 points if he stays there.
Yeah, but it's not going to do him any good right now because he can't pick up a round of racing, right. And that's what he really needed to do. He had an opportunity to possibly do that when qualifying started, but those two bad sessions that he had really hurt him.
And so that's going to bring up the teammates. Arana Jr. slows to a stop at the top end. And it's the Harley team, the Screaming Eagles on the line. Eddie Krawick and Andrew Hines. Andrew Hines currently is number one. That's Drew right there. He has 29 poles thus far in his career. Three-time Pro Stock Motorcycle champion. And his teammate, of course, is a 2008 champion. A feat he accomplished without a race win. Not liking that sky, Mike.
It's a little dark out there, but we're going to be all right. Right now, these guys are going to go for the number one spot. Andrew holds that right now, currently with a 6:82.0. Not great 60 foot.
Hey, Willie G. Davison is on the line. Hines stays number one. Eddie Krawick is going to stay in number three. So now it is 30 poles for Andrew Hines. Let's go to the top end and Gary Gerald.
Hector Arana Jr., it has been an amazing season for you, of course, as your first year of this competition. Been battling for this championship. The odds are against you right now. Do you hold out any realistic hope at this point?
Well, of course, it's not over till it's over, and you know, we've had an excellent year this year, my rookie year. I couldn't ask for any more, so we're just gonna continue doing what we've been doing all year long, consistent, just having fun, and one round at a time, and we'll see what happens.
And I'm sure you feel a whole lot better because the bike shifted all the way through the normal sequence this time as opposed to the earlier qualifying session.
That's right. I'll be able to sleep tonight and be ready for race day tomorrow.
Good stuff. Thanks.
Thank you.
Well, he has a giant's work cut out for him tomorrow. Look at that, 70 points back of Eddie Krawick. So I can say without any question that that man, Eddie Krawick, is probably, almost certainly, maybe the champion. Let's look at the Lucas Oil Ladder Pro Stock Motorcycle and the way they will line up for the last race of the season. Rana, the dad, ends up with Jimmy Underdahl, and that side of the ladder is actually fairly light. Andrew Hines, you're expecting to do well, but Michael Phillips can pull one out every now and then.
Well, Hector Rana Jr. needs Eddie Krawick to go out in the first round. Hector's got Justin Finley in his first round matchup, but look at Eddie Krawick. He's got Karen Stouffer, and that's not such an easy matchup. So obviously Hector Rana Jr. is going to be pulling for Karen in that first round matchup.
And let's catch you up on Top Fuel. Here's John Kernan.
Back in the pits with Spencer Massey, and Spencer currently second in the points, fourth in qualifying. As you see, the way Worsham's running so far this weekend, concerns going in tomorrow for that knockdown dragout?
Yes and no. There's always going to be concerns with any kind of Top Fuel race, especially at the last race of the year and the countdown. It's extremely close. Every round of qualifying is countered. Obviously, we've seen the points lead change. We're now Dell's in the lead. We kind of figured that would happen, changing up. We were hoping that we'd get a shot to get back into it. I don't think we're going to be able to do that. Even if we went low ET of the round and got number one qualifier, we're still going to be 1 point shy. So it doesn't matter what happens next qualifier. We need to make this car consistent. We're going to try and get a 370 out of it because we want to get up there with those guys. Larry and Dell have both run 370s. We want to be right there too. But tomorrow's a different day. It's going to be race day. Reaction times are going to matter, and the car is going to matter. Wind light is the main thing. I want that wind light four times in a row, and it doesn't matter about points because the points take care of itself.
Look for him to throw down a good one coming up.
And speaking of Dell Worsham, as Spencer did, he stepped out of a funny car and back into a Top Fuel dragster for the first time since 1995. Was this he never left. After setting career highs in number one positions and wins, Worsham led the Top Fuel points for much of the season. Then he struggled early on in the countdown to the championship, but he turned things around after shattering the national ET record in Reading. And then in qualifying this weekend, went around Spencer Massey to take number one again. The Auto Club of Southern California Finals, part of the NHRA Full Throttle Drag Racing Series. There is Jack Beckman, second place in the funny car points, and as it says, just seven back from the points leader, Matt Hagan. Hey, at the SEMA show, this was an unveiling. Some familiar colors returning to pro stock. Jed Coughlin unveiled his new car. The new Mopar-powered car should be ready to hit the track in a matter of weeks for testing, and Jed will be back full-time in 2012. Let's take you to Pro Stock round number one.
Vincent Nobile and Greg Anderson. Vincent going for that Rookie of the Year award. Greg Anderson trying to finish second to his teammate. Jason Lyon has already sewn up the championship. Greg makes a nice pass, a 653 at 211 miles per hour. Currently puts him in that number one spot. Vincent's right there with a 656.
And here is the Las Vegas winner, Mike Edwards, and our new champion, Jason Lyon. For Lyon, it's a 653. But for Edwards, it's a 652. And Mike Edwards goes number one. Jason slots into third. And now, session four, and guess what? Mike Edwards still up there at the top, followed by Greg Anderson, who desperately wants to try and finish second in the overall championship so it can be KB one and two.
Field being set right now. You see Alan Johnson, Shane Gray in that ninth and 10th spot. Eric Anders is in 11th position. Buddy Perkinson ends up on the bump with a 6:59.8 elapsed time.
And so out on the track, Ron Krischer is getting ready to take his last run of qualifying for the entire season. And now here comes Shane Gray. Came in late. You saw Rick Stewart. Look over there. Come on, get in here. I'm looking at my watch. Remember, he's going to retire after this race this weekend. Let's go to John Kernan.
And back in the funny car pits with Mike Neff. And Mike, 38 points out right now. You need some more of those little bonus points in qualifying. So what's the game plan for this next pass?
Well, for us, it's, you know, we have to step it up. These are great conditions out here. And obviously Matt Hagan, those guys have a great setup for the good track. And they made a great run the last one. So, you know, I expect them to do that again. So, you know, we're standing all over it, and we got to pick it up. We need to be able to run that good, too. And so we're definitely standing on the gas and hope for the best.
They're going to go for it. It could be spectacular. It'll be coming up.
Well, the field is set in pro stock. This is Shane Gray and Ron Krischer. They are in the bottom half of the field. Gray at 10th, Krischer at 13th. Both looking to take advantage of those conditions Mike Neff just talked about.
Well, they're going to have to run quicker than a 6:56.60 lap time to get in that top half. Ron Krischer's got Mike Edwards' horsepower under the hood, so he gets a setup. He should definitely be able to do it, as should Shane Gray.
Two very powerful cars in a class that is so close. Krischer, 6:60, 6:58 for Gray. Nothing changes. Dave Reif.
Back in the funny car pits with the funny car point leader, Matt Hagan, and we were just talking about the scenario coming up for the fourth qualifying session with the three little points this team earned. Pretty well assured you're going to go into race day tomorrow with that points lead. How comforting is that right now?
Well, you know, it's always great to be leading, not following. You know, we're really just trying to scoop up some points here every session to make sure that we go into the race tomorrow with the points lead. But I think the biggest thing that we got to do there is that allows us for everybody else to have to put an extra round on us. So that's big in itself.
1 year ago, very, very dramatic. Same scenario. You came in, John Force able to come from a couple rounds back. How has it changed now, 1 year later?
Well, you know, it's definitely not over till it's over. I realized that last year. I mean, that was a rude awakening for me. But this year, I think that we're a lot more kind of laid back, relaxed with this deal. We're in a really good spot with it. Our team has done a good job to get us back here. And I have a total confidence in Tommy DeLago that he's going to carry us through and win this thing.
Christiansburg, Virginia is where you come from. It's got to be a great escape to be able to leave this hectic world, go back and do what you do.
Well,
do
you
some
know,
farming, raise the cattle.
Yeah, you know, it works for me, and everybody has to have their own little thing that they do. And for me, it's farming. But I think that, you know, if you don't have that release, if you don't have that thing to go back to and kind of let all this adrenaline go and this competition and the pressure and everything else, you could probably go mad out here. So for me, the farming is my release. It's my therapy, and it really works.
Of course, you lost a lot of weight to be in this position, so all of that's good. But I got to ask you what you did last week and the nice calming thing that you did. You had a nice hunt.
Yeah, I got back home and you know, crawled up a tree about 30 foot and clipped into to my safety harness and hung around. But you know, we had some really nice deer come by the Saturday morning, and I got lucky enough to take a pretty good buck, and it was a good buck for back home on my farm. And we've been trying to manage the farm a little bit and have some big guys running around there, but you know, you just never know when they're going to show up.
Perhaps a good karma moment. Let me ask you simply, are you enjoying this year a little bit more?
Absolutely. You know, this year we're really excited to be back in this hunt. The diehard car is running so strong, and you know, we really just have to take it in and not put too much pressure on ourselves. It's so easy to do that. I think you just got to, you know, let the chips fall where they may, turn it over to the big guy in the sky, and let this thing play out.
I'd be remiss if I didn't ask you, can we look forward to next year yet? Can you tell us your plans?
Well, me and Don Schumacher are working very, very hard to get everything together. We have some stuff in the works, but nothing finalized yet. It's looking like a bright future, but you know, out here in drag racing, anything can happen.
Well, and Don told me the exact same thing yesterday. But hey, thanks for providing us another exciting countdown drama here in Funny Car, and best of luck. Be safe tomorrow. All right?
Hey, Dave, it's always fun with you, man.
And enjoy it.
All right,
it's cool.
I echo that, Dave. It is always fun with you. Erica Enders, Larry Morgan, and I meant that in the nicest way. Erica was the number one qualifier here,
okay,
first race
here
of the season. You listen to Dave Conley talk her through the pre-stage. Larry Morgan, he was a DNQ here last year. Morgan is fifth, Erica is 11th. Track is good. Oh, and Erica breaks right away. Larry Morgan down track.
Right on the wood at all.
Larry Morgan, 6:58. I want to eavesdrop a little.
Yeah, I want to hear what she said.
Larry Morgan, if he stays in that fifth spot, will be his best start of the year. Still not hearing Erica. Maybe they turn the radios on. Well, back in the pits, look at that. That is Jack Beckman. You recognize the guy on the right? That is TV Tommy Ivo, or as many of us who have a little age on us remember as one of the Mouseketeers in the Mickey Mouse Club. Maybe I shouldn't have said that. I'm just thinking.
You're dating yourself there, Paul.
Well, Dell Worsham gets himself ready. He is number one in the points. Top Fuel's final round is coming up. There are the points. Spencer Massey, he's number two in the points. Five back, one session to go. That's what we're looking for, the last man standing at the intersection of Parker and Parks in the L.A. County Fairflex. Here is Vincent Nobile and Roger Brogdon. Brogdon turned 51 this week. Nobile, he's just a kid, but he's going for the Rookie of the Year. His biggest opponent is Hector Arana Jr. Right now, he's trying to improve on his eighth position. And Brogdon is sitting fourth. They always have something funny on the back of Brogdon's car. Right. Now and then it's a note to Mike.
Well, Roger Brogdon's sitting fourth because he made a great pass in the previous session with that 6:55.2 elapsed time that got him in that fourth spot. Quickest run of the previous session, too.
Nobile's quickest pass came in session one. 6:63 with a four. That doesn't improve at all. Brogdon, 6:59. Talking about that Rookie of the Year battle. Here's what everybody thinks are the two contenders. The votes are all in. They'll be counted in secret. It will be announced at the NHRA Full Throttle Banquet on Tuesday, on Monday night. Mike, where'd you vote? Come on.
Well, I can tell you it's going to be one of these two drivers here, but I don't know which one because they have both done an excellent job this season.
It's going to be tight. Yep. No question about it. Jason Lyne and Kurt Johnson are up now. We go to John Kernan.
And I'm down in Jack Beckman's pit, and he's having a nice little conversation with TV Tommy Ivo, as we showed you just a few moments ago. And Jack, you're holding Tommy's book there. So anything you're learning there about how to maybe overtake Matt Hagen tomorrow and win the championship?
Listen, apparently it's all about fire burnouts and drama. I don't think Ron Tobler or Don Schumacher are going to let me do fire burnouts. But you know what's awesome? Pomona is the site of the NHRA Wally Parks Museum, and it's kind of the hub of motorsports. And guys like Tommy, we go to the museum on Friday night, and the true legends and pioneers of the sport are there. As a fan of the sport since I was a little guy, to be around guys like this is bigger than life.
So Tommy, what do you think about Jack as a driver? I mean, you know, you've had all this experience and you've seen them come and go.
You know, I'd love to get in them and drive one of these things again. The only problem is I back over trash cans now and drive over curbs, so I don't belong in a race car anymore. So I root for Jack.
Well, and RJ, if we can pan the camera over here, tell us about this new NHRA fan.
It's my baby Layla's four-month birthday, and if Layla sounds like an interesting name, our son Jason heard the Clapton song on the radio, would not let it go. So yes, four-year-olds do rule our house.
Now seriously, getting ready to make the final qualifying pass of the day, getting ready for tomorrow, how do you like your chances?
We're in. This time yesterday we weren't in, so you know, we talked about this. The drama's kind of over for us. We got the luxury of trying to improve, and if we don't improve, we got Tim Wilkerson first round. And I don't know if you've looked at the ladder, but if things go the way the favored cars are, we'd have Matt Hagen second round. If we get this run, that'd be great. We would like to try to get some qualifying points. If we don't get this run, we're qualified. We know Sundays are good days, and I hope it's a great one tomorrow.
Thanks, Jack.
Tommy Ivo in my pit area. It doesn't get any better.
No, it doesn't. And hopefully he gave you the book for free, or did you have to buy it?
At $28 and well worth it, you guys ought to buy a copy. I don't get a percentage, by the way.
Did you autograph it?
I was going to say, of course I did.
Back at Charlotte, he was the official starter, and I think he was into it more than most of the fans. I can still sing the Mouseketeer song.
TV Tommy Ivo, he's a legend. He pioneered the match race circuit. One year he ran over 120 dates in one season.
Here, number one and number two in the qualifying. Mike Edwards, and Greg Anderson. Anderson holds the track record ET. It's a 6.52 with an 8. Edwards, though, been the number one qualifier 39 times. He may be ready to do it again. By the way, Edwards did take that record away during qualifying here. Rick Stewart, who will be retiring at the end of this weekend. No indication, but I hear Mike Dunn is in the running. But you got to get the rain indicator down a little better, Mike.
I've been working on that. I've been practicing quite a bit, but right now we're focused on Mike Edwards and Greg Anderson. Mike should end up being the number one qualifier for the third race in a row based on what we've seen thus far in this session. But Greg Anderson is going to try to make a perfect run and see what kind of number he can put up.
Numbers come up. Anderson 6.58 flat, 6.58 with a one for Edwards. Jason Line looks on. Edwards is going to stay number one. So he's now 40 times a number one qualifier. Go on board with Greg.
Well, this is what he's going to need to do tomorrow. Greg Anderson, 0.17 reaction time. You know he's practicing for tomorrow. Had a good 60-foot. Mike Edwards was slightly better than 60-foot, but Greg Anderson got to the stripe just a thousandth of a second before Mike Edwards.
The Lucas Oil Ladder for Pro Stock for the final race of the season of the NHRA Full Throttle Drag Racing Series. Vincent Nobile will face a fellow Mopar driver. That'll be Alan Johnson.
Other side of the ladder for Greg Anderson to finish in the second position. He's first going to have to get around his old boss, Warren Johnson.
Well, the excitement and drama of a championship run isn't just reserved to drivers. Crew chiefs and crews also feel that. And when we come back, it'll be funny car qualifying as we check the diehard crew chief, Tommy DeLago, and find out how he prepares for Championship Sunday.
The NHRA Full Throttle Drag Racing Series, the Auto Club of Southern California Finals. This is the final session of qualifying for Funny Car with Peter Rosso and Terry Haddock up on the line. Well, Terry Haddock comes out, little sprinkles coming down. We've been dodging these all day. Here are the standings. Matt Hagan, number one as a contender in the championship. So is Robert Height, so is Mike Knapp. Melanie Troxell is not a contender in the championship, but Cruz is. Jack Beckman, who rounds out the top eight, is also a contender.
Bottom eight, we've got some big names in there, including Ron Kapp, John Force, Bob Tasca. Bob Bodie is on the bump with a 4:19.9 elapsed time.
A list of those who's not qualified, including the two on the line, Russo, the Australian, and Terry Haddock. Haddock had his problems here, had a big explosion and fire, oiled the track down. Now he's back, got everything fixed, and he is ready to go. From Temple, Texas, Terry Haddock. Raced in both Top Fuel and Funny Car. And there's the Aussie. And the bump, Bob Bodie, 4:19 with a 9.
Yeah, Peter Russo, he raced quite a bit down in Australia. He's been around for a number of years. But he's going to have to run a pretty good number to get in this show. He hasn't, I don't think, run anything close to that recently. And Terry Haddock, same thing. He's going to have to lay down a nice pass. A 4:19 bump. I mean, that's a pretty stout bump right now. Not our quickest, but still a good bump.
Russo. As we look at Haddock, that's a brand new car, only the second race that he's tried to get into. He was at Vegas but never had a decent run. Both trying to make it in. How far over Russo? And they both go and then they stop. And so there's two guys that will join the rest of us as spectators and fans for the finals. The last day of the season. We go to John Kernan.
Back in the staging lanes with Cruz Pedregon. And Cruz, that third session was nerve-wracking for you, but you made it in fifth so far. What do you do here?
Well, we're just going to try to see what the track will hold. And that was a pressure pack. Man, we were aging fast on that one. But the car, we got it right, got the happy medium spot in it. But I think if it stops raining here, we're going to test the track, see if we can't kick Pomona into the ocean here.
Speaking of kicking it into the ocean, you probably need great performances and monster performances on Sundays during eliminations to have a shot at winning the championship. Do you still like your chances, or do you consider yourself a long shot?
No, not a long shot. We like our chances, but Hagen's running good. You know, we'll give credit where credit's due. We're going to have to go out there and just mind our own business and race hard and, you know, see who's standing at the end. It's going to come down to that. We always like our chances. We're in it. Got to be in it to win it, though. Thanks.
We look at the points here. Cruz is just 31 points back. Jack Beckman in second is 7 back. Neff, there's a pretty good chance there. A little longer odds for both Robert Height and Ron Capps. Well, they've got some light rain coming through here, and this might be a fun time to just look ahead at what the ladder might be if they were to go just the way they are now, a provisional ladder as it is. And Matt Hagen would be up against Bob Bodie. Jack Beckman would take on Wilkerson. Now, Beckman has a tough opponent there. That could end his countdown. Melanie Troxell and Alexis DeJoria, and then Cruz Pedregon faces Bob Tasca. You remember Tasca last year helped John Forrest to a title.
On the other side of the ladder, that battle for the championship, Robert Height would have to take out John Capps. And Mike Neff, he's going to have to take out Gary Dentham. That's never an easy task.
And I'm sure the light sprinkles that are going through the area here as you look up towards Mount Baldy are not what Matt Hagen would have liked. He'd like to see this session over so he can relax, get his game face on, and get ready for tomorrow. We'll be right back. Dale Worsham's pit, waiting out a little moisture on the track. At the end of Sunday, will he be the Top Fuel champion? Still a lot to be decided. Spencer Massey and Dale Worsham. They're at the top of the point standing, separated by less than one round of racing. A few weeks ago in Reading, Spencer Massey struck a major blow for his title bout. Worsham turned in the quickest elapsed time, but he was slower at the tree, and that gave Massey the win on a hole shot. At our last event in Las Vegas, Dale Worsham struck back. This time, the two were separated by only a hundredth of a second at the start. Worsham drove around Massey and took the win by 18 ten-thousandths of a second. Let's go to John Kernan.
And down in the pits with Dell Worsham. And Dell, we just saw some of the close battles over the last few weeks between you and Spencer Massey. As a driver, going up against another talented driver with a good car, how much fun is that?
Yeah, it's fun. Definitely when you win, they're fun. Spencer's a very good driver. You know, keeps these, extremely honest up there along with Antron and Larry and Tony and all them. But, you know, Spencer and I have been racing pretty much since the very first race of the season. We've been racing all season long, and I don't know if we've raced 8 or 9 times, but they've always been close races. They've always been by a nose either way. And it's exciting. And like I said, you know, when you lose them, they're devastating and heartbreaking. But when you win them, they sure are exciting.
You know, this has been a quest of 21 years, I believe, for you in the making, trying to grab that championship. Have you allowed yourself to think what it would be like if tomorrow afternoon you are the Top Fuel champion?
Yeah, I thought about it. I thought about it a little bit, but you know, I really don't want to. I don't want to get myself too excited about it or be let down that bad. So at this point, you know, I just want to go out tomorrow and do the best job I can. And if good fortune goes our way and we're able to do something here, it's gonna be very exciting Monday night.
Yes, it will be.
We'll see where it all goes. There have been some amazingly close finishes between Massey and Worsham. Like at Reading, you know, what are we talking? 5 feet. But remember, that's a still photo at over 300 miles an hour.
And then how about in Las Vegas? Just 10 inches was the margin of victory. Dell Worsham over Spencer Massey. Wow.
And talking about Spencer Massey, here he is with Dave.
Yeah, it certainly has been a game of inches. And Spencer Massey's been on the right side of some of those, been on the wrong side of some of those. And, you know, when you sit back and think of what's gone on in the countdown so far this year, with the exception of what you hope tomorrow brings, what's been the moment for you?
I guess I definitely have to say Reading, final round, beating the actual national record run. That was pretty outstanding for our whole entire Fram team and myself. It makes myself feel better when he went on any hole shots, much less that one. That definitely put us right in the position to where we are now. The downside, of course, was Phoenix. Didn't qualify. That's huge not to qualify in the countdown. Would be a big statement is if we can come on out on the top tomorrow. That's what we've been hoping to do all season long. That's why I got hired on. That's what Phil and Todd have been breathing down our necks to try and do all weekend long and all season long. Now we're here, going to try and make it happen.
I love standing right to the left of you, Mitch King. You've been in this position before, back when you were running for an IHRA championship. Is the feeling the same?
Oh, yeah. No matter what, you're driving a top fuel car or any category, if you're going for a championship, you have a lot of stress and a lot of people behind you wanting you to win. Me and Mitch, we had it back in 2008. It came down the last race of the year, and we got the win, and we won the world champion. Now I'm going to try and repeat and try and do it again. And Mitch has Keith Mert driving his car, but he's still here supporting our group.
Who's your money on for this championship? Is it right here? Spencer Massey. There you go.
Well, we're going to show you the provisional ladder now. Again, nothing settled here, but you take a look at this, and Spencer Massey will face, you talk about ironies, already he's mentioned his IHRA championship last race of the season. He will face Corey McLenathan, who had the Fram car last year.
On the other side of the ladder, take a look at this. Larry Dixon's going to run up against Keith Mert. Antoine Brown up against Bob Vandegrift. That means Larry Dixon and Antoine Brown possibly could meet up in the second round.
And consider Antoine Brown, now that he is qualified, third in the points, just 20 back. Top fuel driver, Antoine Brown. He's been no stranger to winning in the NHRA. And in 2011, he added some big event wins to his already impressive career. He fulfilled his lifelong dream of winning the U.S. Nationals in top fuel. And by doing that, he also became the fifth driver in NHRA history to win the big go in two different classes. And has zero round one losses on the season and six national event wins. And when we come back, we will hear from Antoine Brown. Auto Club Raceway, Pomona, California. It's the Auto Club of Southern California Finals, the final event in the NHRA full throttle drag racing season. We'll crown the champions here on Sunday in three classes. Well, you see that the sky's cleared out a little bit. They're still trying to get the track totally dry, but they say there is still a possibility we're going to finish this qualifying. The chase for the NASCAR Sprint Cup continues with the Cobalt Tools 500 at Phoenix. Coverage begins Sunday at 2 o'clock with two races left in the chase. Let's go now to John Kernan with Antoine Brown.
And Paul, down here in the pit area, talk to some of the teams who wish that the rain would just come and wash out this final segment of qualifying. However, Antoine Brown's team is not one of them because they need another session in order to get some little bonus points so you go into tomorrow not more than a round out, right?
Oh, without a doubt. And that's what we were counting on. And we knew this run today, we had to go in and try to get in. And Dale's team, they've been making up some really crucial qualifying points. So now we got to go out there and it's clearing off, and we're hoping for the best because we're going to go out there and give it a shot because we want to go for that number one spot. We're not going to go out to try to go down the racetrack. We're going out there for that number one spot because it's things you have to do right now to contend for this championship right now. And we just want that chance to do it.
If you don't get a chance to go back out and the lead that you're behind Dell goes up above the 20 points, above one round, what can you do tomorrow to make that up? I mean, do you just throw everything at him?
Yeah, I mean, we just got to go out there and do the best that we can do. And the conditions tomorrow are looking really good. So we can go out there, just try to run low, try to run some 70s, and then hopefully if you can make it to the final, maybe have a chance to maybe set a world record or try for it, or you might not have to. I mean, I see right now the way it stands, Dale and Spencer on the same side. They can see each other in the semi. So my deal is hopefully we can get that far, and then Spencer could take him out, and then maybe me and Spencer can race for the championship in the final. So that's what we're hoping for, but it's a lot of tough round matchups. But that's just hypothetically and hoping, you know. So we'll see what happens.
Well, speaking of hypothetically, you could face Larry Dixon in that second round, another one of the championship contenders.
Oh, without a doubt. That's what I'm saying. It's a lot of tough round matchups, you know. And we got to go out there and just do what we do. And it's going to be monster matchups all day long. And it's going to be some fun. So we're going to see what happens. And we'll see what we can do.
It is going to be fun tomorrow. Fun to watch as a fan, but nerve-wracking for these guys. Let's go to Dave Reif.
Well, the excitement of this championship certainly being felt by Tommy DeLago. And, Tommy, I'm kind of curious. 1 year removed from what happened a year ago when you came into the runner-up spot, how do you prepare differently tonight for Championship Sunday tomorrow?
Well, it's an experience thing. It's a learning process. And you never know if it's going to work. So our plan this year is just to relax, have fun, and enjoy it. I mean, just to have a chance at a championship 2 years in a row, and even if it's 1 point or 35 points like last year, to show up in Pomona at the last race in the lead 2 years in a row, that's pretty special. And it's great. It's great for all of us. It's great for our sponsors. And we're just having fun.
You don't have any superstitions, something you will absolutely do tonight, do you?
No, actually, I have superstitions, but nothing that I'll do tonight. I mean, I'll make sure that I wear the same shoes. I'll make sure that I stop at the same store in the morning and get my smart water. And that's about it.
We cannot wait.
Tommy DeLago. Well, Mike, I don't think we have ever seen it where there are six absolute in-the-game contenders going into the final round of eliminations here in the final event.
I mean, this is pretty amazing. Jack Beckman one round out. Cruz and Mike Neff are two rounds out. Robert Height, Ron Capps got an outside shot. You know, they're four rounds out, but funny car, remember, as wild and crazy and inconsistent as those cars can be, anything can happen tomorrow.
Everything's unpredictable. But what will happen with Matt Hagan? The track has dried out. Matt Hagan has suited up. He's ready to go. Are we talking a national record here? Wow.
Would that be cool or what? Stay with us.
Well, while rain is still very much a factor, qualifying in Funny Car, the fourth and final session back underway. The NHRA Full Throttle Drag Racing Series Auto Club of Southern California Finals. On Sunday, we'll determine who are the final three champions, Top Fuel, Funny Car, and Pro Stock Motorcycle. This is Alexis DeJoria and Tony Pedregon. This is DeJoria, session three.
Session three, you saw the thing going to some severe tire shakes. You had to whip the wheel around a little bit there and then eventually get out of the throttle. You saw the vibration from that Funny Car. But right now they're looking to try to get this thing down the track. They are in the show. 4:15 lap times that they ran in session number two, but obviously they want to try to go from A to B. Tony Pedregon, he's trying to get qualified. He's currently 17th. Bob Bodie on the bump with that 4:19.9.
Tony drifts over to the right, 4:15. That puts him in. Bodie is out, and John Capps is now on the bump. 4:16 with a 5 is the new number. That's Alexis' dad. She is 14th because Tony Pedregon went around her in qualifying. Getting darker and darker, and look at it downstrip.
On board with Alexis right here. You see the car starts to drift over towards the wall, and she got real close to the wall, stepped off of the throttle just before the finish line. That's why her lap time, or her speed, was down to 274 miles per hour. She was probably going to run about a 4:14 on that particular pass had you be able to keep it in the middle of the racetrack and stay on the throttle to the finish.
Well, take a look at this. The air temperature at 61, the track at 67, water grain 77. We're putting all this up because we're wondering about a national record and the 20 points that go with it.
Man, the water grains aren't as high as I thought. Usually if it gets over 100, that's a lot of moisture, but humidity is up there because of the dew point being close to the temperature.
One guy who would be interested and surely capable is Matt Hagan. Let's go to John Kernan.
Heading into this weekend, not a lot of people. We're talking about national records and that extra 20 points that go with it. But in Funny Car, Matt Hagan already has the backup. It's cool right now, Matt. Is Tommy going to go for it?
I don't know. You know, the starting lineup there is I guess, marginal at best sometimes. And, you know, the safety safari has done a really good job with the track. But, you know, I just don't know that it's there. I think that it would be a wise move for us to try to gather up the 3 points and make another consistent run. But I don't know. Tommy's thought is maybe that we don't have much to lose and that we can go for it. But so I never know what's going to happen. Crawl in that race car and have some fun.
Well, it's starting to rain again. Why are we talking about this national record and it's 20 points? It's because we all remember Tony Schumacher going for the championship. They call this the run, Lewis, 2006.
Well, the key thing is the fact that Melanie Troxell beat Doug Coletta on a whole shot. The other fact is that he never led the points, Tony Schumacher, until he crossed the finish line. It was unreal.
And that's why they call it the run, and that's why we're looking for another moment just like that. We'll be right back. ESPN ESPN's presentation of the Automobile Club of Southern California NHRA Finals qualifying has been brought to you by Full Throttle. Grab a Full Throttle energy drink and feel the energy at work. And Auto Club, we're always with you. Now the rain is just pouring down here at Pomona, and the officials have called the event. Qualifying is over. And here is what the funny car points look like with Matt Hagan on top, followed by Beckman, Pedregon, Nev, Robert Height, and Ron Capps. Let's go to Dave Reed.
And we know for Robert Height in that countdown to the championship, you get to race Gary Densham, the guy who drove the Automobile Club car for a while. Still a big mountain to climb. How do you prepare for it?
Well, it's just like any other day. You go in there and you try to win, you know. If nothing falls our way, you know, we still want to win the Auto Club Finals. This is the last race of the year, and you want to go into the off season on a high note. But we're just like the St. Louis Cardinals. We're not giving up. We still believe, you know, things can fall our way. You look back at Vegas, and all three of our Ford Mustangs went out early, first round, by cars that shouldn't have beat us, you know. We beat ourselves. That can happen to the opponents. We have to make sure tomorrow we don't beat ourselves.
John Force, you face probably the hottest car in the countdown, Johnny Gray, who's not a countdown contender, but an even bigger day as this 60th anniversary season, the NHRA, comes to a close. You're the legend. You're starting this tomorrow.
Well, it's an honor to be part of this with the likes of Gartlitz and Shirley and Don Perdomo and so many big names, but we got a race to run here. I've had our traveling road show here this weekend, and boy, 30 cars down there plus the Cacklers, a lot of our cars from both museums. It's kept all of our drivers down there autographing, my girls and Robert and Mike Neff. But right now the focus, we needed that run out there, okay? We needed that run out there tonight in these conditions. We were going for that number, that low, if we could get it. All three teams. I'm struggled. I'm lucky to be in. But tomorrow, I'm going to do some damage. That's what I'm paid to do for Auto Club, Castrol, and Ford, Brand Source, and Mac Tool. I'm going after them. I'm going to help these kids win this championship.
Keep in mind, John Force still is alive and is one of the greatest moments in the 60th anniversary. So, something to look forward to tomorrow. John Kernan.
And I'm with Ron Capps, who has Jeff Arend in the first round and also one of the long shots. But as you told me about a week ago, miracles can happen.
Well, yeah, John, especially here. You know, as we know, this place is 12 feet downhill, and weather conditions like this, with the time change and all, we could see a record set if you can get in the final round. But we were bummed we didn't get this last run, and we were looking to go 403, 404 if we could, and it just didn't happen. Rain came in, and we missed it. My brother with the Biesenbach and Worsham's car got in, but now they got to run my teammate Hagen, so... It's going to be an exciting day tomorrow.
Also an exciting weekend. You signed your contract for next year.
Yeah, I did. Next year, 2012 in Napa, and Don Schumacher again. So we're excited. The best thing about it is Tim Richards will have a fresh start in a whole year with a brand new car. Him and Kim, they signed up as well next year in the same team. So that excites me.
Yeah, it excites all of his fans, too. Let's go back to you, Paul.
You bet it does. The Lucas Oil Ladder and Funny Car. Take a look on this side. Jack Beckman will have to take on Tim Wilkerson. And Cruz Pedregon takes on Bob Tasca. Two contenders with an uphill battle.
Other side of the ladder, contenders Robert Height going to go up against Gary Densham. And Mike Neff, his teammate, is going to go up against Alexis DeJoria.
And how about the points in Top Fuel? The way it looks now, there are four drivers fighting it out for a championship and separated by only 47 points. We'll take a look now at the Lucas Oil Ladder for Top Fuel. And on this side of the ladder, Spencer Massey gets Corey McLenathan first out. Dale Wertham has Mike Ashley.
And on the other side of the ladder, you're going to see Larry Dixon's going to have Keith Burton, Antron Brown up against Bob Vandegrift. Possible second round matchup between Antron and Larry.
Now they have to get ready for the last race of the season. Be a long night for many and a great day tomorrow. Don't miss it.